Yeah, dear students, welcome to the medical visualization lecture where we will continue with direct volume visualization. We discussed already several issues that are essential for direct volume rendering, the classification process, the interpolation process. What we want to add today is primarily how to add more realism to volume rendered images, how to improve the spatial perception and the depth perception by including effects like shadow, global illumination, scattering. So the question is, what is already possible, how this can be realized efficiently? If you remember the requirements we discussed briefly when starting volume rendering, we discussed that rendering should be fast because it should be used interactively, but it should also be precise and incorporate spatial effects that make it easy to understand complex spatial relations as we have them in the human body. And of course, it's so difficult to achieve these goals together simultaneously. But in recent years, indeed, considerable progress was made towards this direction. So there are quite powerful and capable volume rendering tools, even commercially available, that indeed provide at least a very good trade-off of these conflicting goals. Yeah, that's the outline for today. We discuss lighting, shading first. Shading always includes the surface normal, yeah, as you may know from computer graphics. So the question is, what corresponds to a surface normal here when we have volume rendering and no surfaces? We discuss depth queuing, that is how the intensity of light should be modified if the light is further away from the camera or from the viewer. In reality, the light intensity indeed is reduced based on various effects in the atmosphere, and the question how this can be integrated in volume rendering and thus efficiently simulated. In depth perception in the real world, shadows play an important role. Actually, the shadow computation is a bit similar to the normal rendering process, in the sense that we just now compute an image starting from the light source instead of starting from the camera, and that gives us the shadow. Yeah. So the question is how this can be integrated with the rendering process, and also how this can be realized in an efficient manner where the additional effort is strongly reduced. We will discuss further effects like global illumination, ambient occlusion, and scattering. You remember that the volume rendering integral that we discussed when starting with volume rendering was rather simple in the sense that only absorption and reflection were considered, and not any global illumination effects such as reflection or multiple reflections. I have some slides in the slide set that I will not present for the sake of time, but I want to make aware of them at least. That's why I have emphasized this. These are related to validation, that is, to the question, how can we be sure that the volume rendered images that are produced by a certain system indeed correctly reflect the underlying geometry? Yeah? And to give at least the basic idea for this is, validation includes not only tests with realistic data sets, but also tests with artificial data sets that have a clear known geometry, like a rasterized sphere or a rasterized three-dimensional lines, where problems would immediately be obvious. Problems that may result either by a wrong implementation of an algorithm or by parameter choices that are maybe not so ideal because they lead to a trade-off in favor of speed but at the expense of quality. Yeah, and that would become obvious with validation studies. At the end, I want to comment briefly on selected tools for volume visualization. Yeah, what is available there? Basically, there is a substantial number of tools for volume visualization. Meanwhile, I looked up the volume rendering Wikipedia page before this video lecture, and that lists 9 open source tools and 9 commercial tools. Yeah, these are tools that are current and are still under active maintenance. There are some that have disappeared in the meantime, but there are still quite a lot available. Yeah, and this 18 is certainly only a subset of what's available. Now back to this volume rendering pipeline, just to indicate where we are now. We want to discuss the shading and illumination part, not the data traversal part that we discussed with respect to ray casting, for example, not the interpolation that we already also considered. We also briefly discussed gradient computation and classification, which means to apply a transfer function taking into account that different materials occur in a medical volume data set, so that the transfer function could be combined by individual functions that emphasize or suppress certain structures that we assume are available in the data. So a little recap from computer graphics that's important when we want to discuss shading. Yeah? So that is a simple sketch you may remember from computer graphics. We have a surface with a continuous change of the orientation, and at a certain point we want to compute the light intensity. We can compute the surface normal, that is the vector that is orthogonal to the surface, that is orthogonal to the tangential plane at this point. We have the viewer here, labeled with V for viewer, and we have a light source here. We assume that we only have one point light source, and that is in this direction. So the incoming light at this point comes from L, it arrives here, and it is reflected in the same angle R to the surface normal as the incoming light is. Yeah, so the angle between L and N is the same like the angle between R and N. And then we have this second angle here, theta. That describes how far the viewer is away from the direction where he would receive the maximum of the reflected light. Yeah? So the maximum of the reflected light would be achieved if R and V would be the same vectors. So they are in the same direction. So theta tells you how far this is away. And this is modeled with a function that achieves its maximum with theta equals 0. And it goes down continuously if we have values of theta either below or above 0. And the function to model this is the cosinus function. Yeah, you remember that the cosinus has its maximum at 0, where it is 1, meaning that we have the full intensity of the light. Yeah. So that basically is the explanation underlying the Blinn-Phong lightning model, a local interaction of a surface with one point light source. So that is the simplest thing one could do, and that at least should also be incorporated in volume rendering. So I want to make you aware that there are, of course, different light sources. There are point light sources, there are also directed light sources, which means that we model light where the light rays are parallel to each other. That is basically the situation that we have if we consider the sunlight. Yeah? The sun is so far away from us that we can consider the individual rays as parallel. Yeah? Some computations would get faster if we can assume that the light rays are parallel. In addition to point light sources, we also have area light sources, yeah, that have a certain extent. Yeah, it's not just one point. Typically, an area light source is modeled by a set of point light sources. Yeah, so we overlay a grid on this area with a certain resolution that leads to a certain number of point light sources, and we compute the image intensity that arises for these individual components of the area light. Yeah. Why area lights are quite important, and what could be achieved with them that is otherwise not possible? Well, an area light source has the tendency, or the situation, that points on the surface may be reached by part of that area light source, but not by all of them. So we can compute a certain percentage by which it is lighted, and can take this into consideration. The right image here makes you aware of a spotlight source. So a spotlight source is again similar to a point light source because it has one coordinate in space from where it emits light. It does this in a certain, yeah, I would say favorite direction, and the light intensity goes down if we deviate from that favorite direction. And if we are outside this cone, it is zero. Yeah, so this could be seen as a parameter that describes the opening of this cone from a spotlight source. Yeah, so these are light sources. Yeah, how can we incorporate a surface normal in volume rendering? We need to approximate it. And that could be done by computing gradients. Yeah, we briefly discussed gradients in the last video lecture. I want to make you aware that this was done already quite early from Hühne and Bernstein in 1986. That's really a landmark paper, a pioneering paper, and I tried to redraw one sketch of their papers that shows with these arrows the approximated normal directions based on gradients. It is not by chance that we only see a very few arrows and not many arrows, for example, here in these white regions. Yeah, these approximated normals only make sense if the gradient has a certain strength, a certain gradient magnitude. So typically a threshold is applied to make sure that the gradient is only taken into account if its magnitude is above a certain threshold. Why this is so important? If we have homogeneous tissue, then we will have very slight, very small differences between the intensity values. But no matter how small these differences are, we can, of course, compute such a gradient. But it is meaningless. It should not be part of the lighting computation, because otherwise it would emphasize features that are not really there, that are artifacts. Yeah. So for fast rendering, it could be a good idea to pre-compute the gradients. So then we have them available and can use them whenever we need it in the rendering process. Yeah. If this is done without any further technique in a naive manner, then I want to make you aware that the amount of memory, the memory consumption with this technique is really high. Yeah, if we have 16 bits data, as we would have it for CT data, then we now would get 16 bits in the X direction, in the Y direction, and in the Z direction, adding up to 6 bytes for every voxel. Yeah, so the gradient volume that we need in addition to the original data is 3 times as large as the original data volume. And that is somehow not appropriate, because the additional value that we will have when incorporating this is not 300%. Yeah. So therefore, there are ideas which I don't want to comment in much detail that reduce this storage effort considerably by not actually storing the gradient, but instead only discretizing directions of the gradient. Yeah, if you remember how the surface normal is integrated in a lightning process, it is not important whether the normal is small or long, only the direction counts. Yeah, so we can take a sphere that represents all possible directions and overlay a grid on this sphere with a certain accuracy, perhaps with an accuracy of 2 to 3 degrees in horizontal and azimuth direction, and then we would end up, let's say, with 1,000 different directions. 1000 different directions require 10 bits to store instead of 6 bytes. Yeah, so that is how this could be reduced. Yeah, what we see here is an example of an illuminated display of an MRI data set with trilinear interpolation. Here, all gradients were taken into account. Yeah, so that is not desirable. It would be better if small gradients, that is where the gradient magnitude is below a threshold, would be ignored. I just wanted to illustrate with this image that I created many years before with Mavis Lab, what happens if these small gradients are not ignored. Yeah, it looks like the skin of this young, healthy volunteer is quite bumpy, yeah, which it is not in reality. Yeah, so in general, one may say data, medical image data, already has a certain amount of measurement noise. But if you compute a derivative, yeah, like the gradient, that is even more noisy. If you would compute a second order derivative, that would lead to curvature information and is essential for some illustrative rendering techniques, then the amount of noise is even larger. Yeah? So therefore, it is important to somehow consider this noise or to remove it. So we briefly discussed how gradients can be computed. The simplest technique is if I look at the central voxel here, I just take the neighbors in the x, y, and z direction, which gives me 6 neighbors. And from each pair of neighbors, I compute one component of my gradient. I could also incorporate a full 26 neighborhood, yeah, considering my centralized voxel as the center voxel in a 3 by 3 by 3 cube. Then I have to weight the individual components, so the central voxels have a higher importance than those that only share an edge or even only a corner with the central voxel. Yeah, that would give a higher quality, but of course it is slower, not only because we have to consider 26 instead of 6 neighbors, but also because we have to individually weight them. Yeah, so that is considerably slower. Yeah, so we can also compute the gradients on the fly, that means during rendering. That of course has the advantage that we have no memory consumption. We can also come up with better quality, at least in comparison to pre-computed gradients that are only rounded to certain directions. Yeah, but we need many, many accesses to the memory with this. So that could slow down the rendering process. Here we see a comparison based on the book from Klaus Engel and colleagues applied to a CT head data set. On the left you see the use of pre-computed gradients where 8 bits have been used, 2256 different directions were considered, and that is not enough to really represent smooth transitions of the surface normal, whereas on the right we have on-the-fly computation, and there we have virtually a smooth sphere. There are only very subtle stripe artifacts here. Yeah, I want to make aware of some further issues that are essential for shading, gradient-based shading, and want to briefly present an idea that is due to Ronny Jagel, also quite old paper, but the observation underlying it is of course still valid. We typically have situations where we have objects, then we have borders, and maybe we have other objects. So here is a transition in between. If you think back of the process that computes the gradients, that takes a certain neighborhood into account, without any adaptivity. So no matter what happens in this environment, in this surrounding, we take the 6 or 26 neighboring voxels into account. Yeah, actually, it would be better to only take those neighboring voxels into account that belong to the same structure. Yeah, and that is what they tried to estimate, yeah, where there are structures that belong together and where we can interpolate between them and can compute gradients between them, and where there are transitions to a different material where we should not take these values into account. Yeah, so that's became known as context-sensitive shading. Gradient-based shading can be combined with more advanced techniques with multiple light sources. Yeah, in computer graphics, it is known that some very good effects can be achieved if, yeah, an oblique light that comes not directly from the front is combined with light from the sides, or even a small light from the back. Yeah, so that can improve the spatial perception quite considerably. Yeah, gradient-based shading can be combined with all rendering paradigms. So which rendering paradigms we have discussed: ray casting, object-based splatting, and texture-based methods. Yeah, all of these techniques can be combined with gradient-based shading. Also, if we want to enable the user to move a clipping plane through the data set, or two clipping planes, yeah, we discussed this slab rendering, that all is possible. Yeah. So with gradient-based shading, we have simple lighting effects, but we have no shadow. Yeah, please do not confuse these two terms, shading and shadow. That is really something different. Yeah. Shadow computation is actually a second rendering process starting from the light source. Yeah, and gradient-based shading does not incorporate multiple scattering events like they would be considered in global illumination. Yeah, so here is a sketch of optical processes that happen if light traverses different media. Yeah, it arrives at certain surfaces where it is reflected or refracted. That is shown here. And this image models the interaction of light with tissue more realistically, taking also into account that there are small scattering effects where the light intensity is slightly disturbed based on interaction with the particles in that media. Yeah, and so that is the difference between left and right. The difference between the top row and the bottom row is that the top row considers the light intensity as constant over the whole path. The paths that are computed are slightly different, but as the color indicates, it is not changed. Yeah, the full light intensity arrives here at this point exactly the same like we had it here. Yeah, so that is of course simplification. Yeah. And what you see here in the bottom row is more realistic, namely that the light intensity is decreased. And it would already be an improvement if the light intensity is just linearly decreased with the path length, yeah, with the amount of light that is traveled. Yeah, and that could be done for the simple model, but also for the model where we consider scattering as well. So this bottom right image is the most realistic one, taking into account scattering and the light attenuation after the light travels a certain path. So light illumination effects differ in complexity, starting with local shading from a point light source. That's the easiest thing we can do. Local shading with an area light source, as I mentioned, typically represented internally by a set of point light sources, by an array of point light sources. And then there are more complex configurations where we consider multiple scattering with either a point light source, an area light source, or even with multiple light sources, either multiple point light sources or even multiple area light sources. Yeah. Area light sources are essential since they enable soft shadows. With a point light source, an object is either in the shadow or not. That's a binary decision. Yeah. And in reality, if you would look at photographies, there are many situations where you would recognize situations of a soft shadow So there is a gradual transition between objects that are indeed fully in the shadow, in the core shadow, one may say, to regions that are only partially shadowed. Multiple scattering enables to consider refraction and also indirect lighting. Another technique that was used quite frequently, I would say in the last 10 years or so, is ambient occlusion. Ambient occlusion considers the fact that a surface, like an organ, to some extent occludes itself. Yeah, and that depends. For some voxels, this effect is not so important. For a concave region, points in this concave valley, there ambient occlusion plays an important role. Yeah, so therefore, even more realism could be achieved if ambient occlusion is computed. But let's start with simple comparison. We have the same data sets, CT data sets, showing skeletal structures in the foot area. They are shown on the left with a conventional direct volume rendering. Yeah, so that's no maximum intensity projection, also that's a direct volume rendering. And on the right, with the same parameters for interpolation, and also with the same sampling distance for the computational process, the only difference is that shading is incorporated. And I think you may agree that the spatial effects are more clearly, we can better imagine the shape of these bones, and that's the major reason for using 3D visualization at all, to get a better understanding of spatial relations and of depth relations, e.g. what is in front and what is further away. So this is a more recent comparison of three images from the SIGGRAPH course of the gang of volume rendering experts in 2008. Here, different illumination and rendering modes are compared. That is, yeah, the basic method where only emission and absorption is considered with the simple volume rendering equation. Yeah, and based on this high resolution and high quality data set, even with the simple method, the results do look quite convincing. On the right, or in the middle, we have additionally shading incorporated, and that becomes particularly obvious here, where we have a part of the, yeah, of the skull that has a direction that is tangential plane, that is orthogonal to the light source. So obviously the light comes directly from the front. And then this specular highlight really becomes obvious. On the right, there is a semi-transparent isosurfacing also incorporated, making the image even a bit more realistic. So if you compare this image and this one, not in all regions you see more in the middle image. Yeah, this specular highlight here may even, yeah, overshadow to some extent structures that that are there. The precise cause of the surface is a bit difficult to understand there. Yeah, then let's discuss depth queuing. That is the effect of a reduced light intensity when the light goes further away, when it interacts with more particles within the material it is traversing. So typically it is assumed as a homogeneous absorbing fog effect. Yeah, and it is indirect, independent from the light direction. So that is not taken into account. The effect that typically is aimed at is that structures that are further away appear darker. Yeah. So artists have a nice saying about this technique. They say dark means deep. Yeah. If something is far away, that means the Z values are high, then it gets deeper. Yeah. How we can realize this and implement this? Of course, we can compute for every voxel how far it is. Yeah. So this gives us a distance value d, and then we need a function, we will call it a fog function, t fog, that depends on d. So we have our normal computation of the light intensity, and in the final step combine this with the fog function. Yeah? So the problem with this naive implementation would be that we have to compute a function for every voxel in addition to the rendering effort that we have so far. It depends, of course, a bit on the function, how expensive this is, but typically this function is an exponential function. So we have an initial light intensity, and then we have an exponential decay, yeah, where this parameter p controls how strongly the light intensity goes down. Yeah. So this exponential function is quite expensive. Yeah. We should avoid that we have to compute an exponential function in the inner core of our volume rendering for every voxel. Yeah. So, and actually that is also not necessary, because it is completely sufficient if we approximate this effect. And with approximation, I mean, well, it would be completely sufficient, instead of computing a precise value, just to discretize the range of possible tfog values, for example, in 256 values, 256 steps, one could also say. Yeah, and why I use 256 as the example, of course, because this can be stored within one byte. Yeah. So instead of computing the fog function for 30 million voxels, we compute it only for 256 different d values, different distances, and store this in a lookup table. And whenever we come across the point where we need the fog value, we just look it up, because we have it already available for these 256 different distances. Yeah, that is the smarter way to do this. And here, really, the effect, the comparison between the full computation of the fog function and such a lookup table would not be noticeable. Yeah, the difference is so small that you could not identify whether a small lookup table was used or the full function was computed for every voxel. So here is again a comparison from Phil Lacroute's PhD thesis in 1995. On the left, the CT-HET dataset is shown without depth queuing, and on the right, depth queuing is enabled. Yeah, if you look a little bit longer, then you clearly see regions where the effect of this is more obvious. Yeah? So for example, when you look in the eyes, then you can look quite far based on this transfer function in the data set. So that leads to the darker impression that you have here compared to the situation that you have here. A similar situation arises here within the nose. Yeah, so that was depth queuing. Then we have shadows. Yeah, that further improve the spatial impression. That is something we know from reality, and that may help us with additional cues to understand a complex shape. Yeah, so of course shadows require a light source, so that is the similarity that it has with shading. Yeah, but shading is a different thing than shadow computation. So with shadow computations, we have to analyze the orientation, that is the gradient that we have computed, of the voxels in relation to the light sources. And this could be realized in the way that we first compute for every voxel the illumination and store this in a shadow buffer. And in the second rendering pass, we use this shadow buffer and integrate it in the overall rendering process. However, that requires a 3D shadow buffer that has the same size like the volume data set. Yeah, so that's quite large. So there are other approaches, more recent approaches, of course, that try to achieve one of two things with respect to the complexity, either to reduce the memory consumption or to increase the performance. Yeah, two examples are a paper from the Zuse Institute Berlin called Deep Shadow Maps, and another one from Salvi et others, Adaptive Volume Matrix shadow maps. I don't want to go into detail how these algorithms work, but instead give you some results to give a little idea of which effects can be achieved with this. That is from Andrea Kratz's paper. A direct volume rendering on the left, here MRI data from the brain, obviously, and here CT data from the head region that shows with this specific transfer function the skeletal structures, a little bit the skin, but also the vascular structures. Yeah, here shading is incorporated, leading to a little better spatial impression, and here as well. And here, direct volume rendering is combined with shadows. Yeah. So that adds more realism than this original direct volume rendering. Yeah. If you look at the ventricles here, for example, these become more clear with shadowing, because here, parts of the ventricles cast a shadow on other parts of the ventricles. A few remarks on global illumination. Yeah, if we want to realistically incorporate lighting effects even in a physically correct way, then of course we have to consider global effects and not just the local interaction of a light source with tissue. Yeah, so that includes scattering, refraction. So that is quite computationally heavy. Yeah, so for a long time, global illumination was only applied to surface models of a moderate complexity, let's say of one mega or 1 million of vertices, but not to volume data sets with 30, 50, or even 100 megavoxels. Yeah? But that changed in the very last years based on improvements of graphics hardware, but also on implementation. Yeah. So instead of a full global illumination solution, often a good trade-off is to consider at least ambient occlusion. If ambient occlusion would be implemented in a naive manner, that would also be very expensive from a computational point of view. But it is often approximated in screen space with an appropriate resolution, and then it becomes feasible. Yeah. So what is ambient occlusion about? The sketch from Penner and Mitchell is quite illustrative, I think. Yeah. We have a rather complex shape of a material, not necessarily, of course, a medical one, and we have a certain surface normal at a particular point, and we look without taking into account any light source, we just look over the half sphere that is above this point, and we want to understand how many of the rays that we can send in the different directions within this half sphere would be occluded by the surface. Yeah, so the black part here, that is approximately 1/4, 25% of the whole half circle in 2D, would be occluded. Yeah, so therefore this would be a point that is rendered darker compared to a point that you could imagine that would be here. Yeah, if you would look for the half sphere at a point P that is here at my cursor position, then of course almost nothing is occluded, 1% perhaps. Yeah. So then the light intensity is higher. That is the effect that should be considered with ambient occlusion. So this could be done in object space or in image space. The image space variants, screen space variants are faster. Yeah. So here we see results. Again, I have not explained the algorithm and do not expect that you are able to re-implement this, but want to make you aware of the effects that would be achieved. Diffuse illumination, so that would be local shading with the Phong Bling model. And here is a close-up that shows this a little bit more clearly. Yeah, here we have ambient occlusion instead. Yeah, And that leads to a better realization that becomes obvious if you look here in the close-up. By the way, even this rendering is far from perfect. It has one problem that we briefly discussed in the last video lecture. It is not boundary aware, as the colleagues from Norrköping would call it. That means we interpolate in such a way that we have a color bleeding here between the skull that should be rendered in white and the nearby vascular structures. Yeah, so a boundary aware technique would avoid this. Yeah, just some more examples to show different effects that can be achieved when we consider some lighting effects such as scattering, or whether this is omitted. It's based on a paper from Markus Hartwiger. That's also one of the pioneers and experts of volume rendering, also one of the authors of this book on volume rendering, and one of the authors of these SIGGRAPH course notes that I have cited already several times. Yeah. So here are three enlarged images. The Chameleon dataset is really nice because it has such a high spatial resolution, so that even subtle differences can be shown. Yeah. So here ambient occlusion is added, yeah, which was not added here, and you see that this has a quite considerable effect. The differences are quite clearly visible, and here scattering is additionally incorporated in the right image. Light maps means that the lighting effects are pre-computed. You see that we often discuss to pre-compute things, either in small lookup tables, as we have done it for the realization of a fog function for depth queuing, or leading to a larger structure like the shadow map. Here we discuss light maps. So that could be done to compute the effects that point light sources have and the effect of forward scattering. Yeah. Here are comparisons where such light maps are used on the right here and here, and not used on the left. Yeah. So the left images are not so good to recognize, because in essence, the overall image intensity that arrives when we only consider local illumination is just too low. Yeah. So for some areas, the light intensity is just quite small, and the contrast to a dark background is not sufficient. The problem is, of course, that these light maps, they can be reused when you rotate the model, and if you have a clipping plane that you move through the model, that's all fine. But whenever you change the transfer function, then you have to recompute this light map. Yeah, what is available from commercial vendors? What is meanwhile really the state of the art in photorealistic volume rendering? I would say the state of the art in photorealistic volume rendering is the cinematic rendering that was introduced by Siemens Healthcare, I think in 2016 or 17. It's a few years from now on, meanwhile. Yeah, here on the right, you see such an image rendered with cinematic rendering. That is still not absolutely perfect. You have a number of parameters to control the cinematic renderer, and these parameters basically control the trade-off between quality and speed. If you want to enable high-quality rendering with ambient occlusion, shadowing, and other major illumination effects, as it was done here, then the performance is still quite slow. Yeah, so that is something where the image computation still takes considerable time. You need to reduce these effects at least to approximate them more in order to achieve high frame rates, at least if you have volume data sets that are quite large. Yeah, but I think that is currently the best available solution. Yeah, just some references to the cinematic renderer. There are discussions how this rendering method can be really used in practice. Yeah, I always want to find relations between what we discuss here in the medical visualization lecture in terms of algorithms and techniques to clinical problems. Yeah, and I wanted to include cinematic rendering after having read a number of papers that show that there are special diagnostic applications where the increased spatial impression possible with the cinematic rendering really have an effect on assessing a pathology more correctly. Yeah, so I don't want to go in the details here, but leave it with mentioning some references. Yeah, I want to discuss this a little bit. Illumination is essential for achieving volume rendered images where spatial relations, that means the local orientation of surfaces, and depth relations, e.g. What is in front and what is farther away, are clearly visible. So this perception is clearly enhanced with illumination effects. We have seen that there is a broad spectrum of effects. Many different things can happen when light interacts with certain tissue types. Although I just cited on the last slide some examples, some specific examples where advanced lighting is important for clinical practice, in most cases it is not so important. But where it really helps in many cases is for educational purposes, yeah, also because these nice renderings have a motivational effect, and they also help for patient consulting. That means when a physician explains to a patient the pathology, the spatial relations, and the surgery that is planned, yeah, and the physician is obliged to do so, yeah, surgery can only be applied to a person, to a patient, if she has agreed to this explicitly. Therefore, anything that improves this patient consultation process, reduces anxiety in patients, is quite valuable. Yeah? Sometimes these effects are achieved at the expense of interactivity, yeah? In the sense that the frame rate gets lower. Yeah? We discussed a little bit more in detail the gradient computation, because that is at the heart of shading effects and illumination effects. Gradients can be approximated, which involves some quality reduction, but that may be acceptable. So I skip six slides. These are the slides related to validation. You would find them if you are interested, but I don't want to comment them. Instead, I want to comment a bit on tools for volume rendering. Yeah. VTK, the visualization toolkit freely available, is a pioneer for very nice implementations of many visualization techniques, and it also provides the volume renderer. I also want to mention the Volume Pro, a little bit for historical reasons, to be honest, because that was the first hardware accelerated volume rendering system. That was rather widely available. It was certified to be used for medical diagnosis. So Siemens, Toshiba, and others have sold their workstations with 3D volume rendering based on the Volume Pro dataset, Volume Pro graphics card. Vorin is an open source system that was developed in Linköping and before at the University of Münster. I have included a link there. Also, VoxLib is a system that was developed in Edinburgh by a company called Voxar. A German company, Volume Graphics, developed the VGL, Volume Graphics Library. MeVisLab is the tool that you get to know in the exercises, so I want to comment at least very briefly on the volume rendering capabilities of MeVisLab. And I also want to mention at least briefly the 3D slicer, that is a very powerful open source toolkit with many advanced functions for image processing, segmentation, registration and others, but also for volume rendering. I incorporated also a link to a Wikipedia site where 18 tools are listed in total. Yeah, so what are criteria to compare such tools? The quality and efficiency of the rendering, of course, the supported platforms. Yeah, so maybe you want to develop for the Macintosh as a target platform, which would be reasonable because many physicians are familiar with the Apple platforms, then this, of course, is essential. Integration with image processing algorithms, so therefore something like MeVisLab or the 3D Slicer that provide advanced image processing together with quite capable volume rendering might be beneficial. Yeah, import and export options are also some practical things that are important, and documentation and service, of course. Yeah, and finally, money is of course also important. Do you need a license for this, and how expensive this is? These would be criteria that I would take into account. Yeah, so VDK is really a mature toolkit. Can be integrated with TickleTK and Java to come up with user interfaces on top of your visualization application. Legends can be incorporated, labeling texts, yeah, that is often quite essential, and the major interaction techniques like clipping and cutting and extraction of data values. Yeah, if surfaces are combined with volume rendered images, then VDK involves quite good smoothing techniques. Yeah, so VDK is available via Kitware. The Volume Pro was introduced in 1999. That's one of the most highly cited scientific papers on volume rendering from Hans-Peter Pfister, because that was a GPU realization of volume rendering that was widely available, much cheaper than any previous effort, and it was quite efficient. The rendering was realized with the shear warp transformation. That is a technique that was the fastest software realization available at that time. it combined some advantages from texture-based volume rendering with early ray termination from image-based rendering. Maximum intensity projection was possible, and illumination, as we have just discussed it, as well. Yeah. So the first Volume Pro was labeled Volume Pro 500, which means it has a performance of approximately 500 megavoxels per second. Yeah. That means for a data set with 256 times 256 times 256 voxels, a frame rate of 30 could be achieved. However, it was restricted to parallel projection, and that is a problem in some applications, in particular with the Volume Pro 500, virtual endoscopy was not possible. Yeah, it was just a bit too complex to realize these computations in hardware that was done in a later variant of the Volume Pro. Yeah, and surface geometries could not be incorporated. Volume Pro 1000 was introduced 2 years later by Terra Recon. 1000, of course, means that now the performance was doubled. So even larger data sets could be rendered in real time. And you see that, yeah, the quality of the rendering was quite nice, at least with these high quality data sets. And the Volume Pro 1000 also enabled perspective volume rendering and thus virtual endoscopy. Yeah. Maximum intensity projection was of course also possible, as you see in the image on the right. Yeah, some more examples of the image gallery from the Volume Pro 1000. So that was already possible with quite high performance in 2001. Yeah, Voxar 3D, that was a system that was used by Toshiba, for example, because it was really certified as a rendering library that could be used in medical products for patient use. Yeah. So in the slides that I have not shown, validation was discussed. This certification, of course, is based on very comprehensive validation studies. Yeah. Voxar 3D also incorporates virtual endoscopy, curved multiplanar reformation, bone removal that is important if you want to focus the visualization on vascular structure. Yeah, if you have CT angiography data, that all was available here. And they provided some special packages like cardiac analysis or CT colonography for polyp detection in the colon. And also one topic that will be discussed in the next video lecture, namely multimodal medical visualization. Yeah, Volume Graphics, that was the tool from Heidelberg. They developed Volume Graphics Studio and Volume Graphics Studio Max. When I more recently looked up what they did, they specialized a bit more in one type of applications that is not so directly relevant for us here, namely for industrial CT data set. That means for applications in material science. Yeah. So there the goal is to test material without destroying it, yeah, non-destructive testing. And they also need quite capable volume rendering solutions. And what the volume graphics developers did is to develop some special tools to support frequent tasks of material scientists. Yeah, Boreen from Jens Meyer-Sprado and Timo Rupinski is not only a volume renderer, but a whole system with a data flow and a visual programming environment where you can combine light sources, clipping planes, bounding boxes together with components of a volume renderer that are shown at a certain canvas at the end. Yeah, so the net starts with a source, yeah, of course, and yeah, for efficient rendering, a proxy geometry is needed. That is what we have discussed, and that is fit here in. Here we have the Raycaster, that is the core of the volume renderer, and then additional components until something is actually visible in a canvas. Yeah, that is Boreen. Here is just another example, again starting with the source and canvas at the end, but now integrating some glyphs here on the surface of a ventricle of the heart. Yeah, so some property was simulated for the heart, and that is conveyed here. So that is a kind of surface rendering combined with glyph rendering, which you see here. Yeah, and this glyph rendering is also done in a quite modular fashion. So there is one algorithm responsible for glyph placing, then the actual glyph generator, which takes into account a basic shape and modifies it depending on the value that should be shown. Yeah, that comes here from the volume selector. And then this is finally rendered and combined with the mesh rendering process in the canvas. Yeah, Mewis Lab, I think that should be mentioned as well, because that's the tool that you use in your exercise, and also because it's a tool that is meanwhile quite widely used. There is a free version that you can use in academic situations, but also a commercial solution that is used, for example, by Siemens for many prototyping activities. The volume renderer is one of the strong components of Mewis Lab. It's the so-called Giga Voxel renderer. So already in 2006, Florian Link and his team came up with this renderer that was able to render a data set with a billion mixed voxels in real time, yeah, including effects like gradient-based shading. Yeah, you know from the exercise that similar to Voreen that we have just discussed, MeVSTEP also has such data flow architecture, a visual programming approach. Yeah, so you can open a node and get a certain user interface in order to parameterize it. Yeah, so what you here see, the opened node is the transfer function editor, where you can specify a transfer function by dragging on these control points. And as essential context to achieve an appropriate transfer function, you see the histogram of that data set, so that you can deliberately emphasize certain peaks in the data set, for example. Yeah, and that is the final image here. So corresponding to the canvas operator in vivo, here we have a viewer, the examiner viewer, that goes back to Open Inventor as the basic library that is used extensively in MeVSTEP. Yeah, so I want to summarize. I wanted to make you familiar in an overview style with illumination effects in volume rendering, like shading, depth queuing, and shadowing. We discussed several times trade-offs between interactivity and quality. Pre-computed gradients have a lower quality compared to on-the-fly gradients, for example. So if you think in a particular application which effects to enable, then really think about the task, make some comparisons, discuss with the physicians, is a certain illumination effect really beneficial for this application or not? Yeah, and you should consider diagnosis, but maybe also other scenarios such as patient consultation and education. There are many freely available tools, but also commercial tools, and there is quite capable graphics hardware available meanwhile. So nothing special like the Volume Pro graphics card is needed currently, but the conventional graphics cards from NVIDIA and ATI, for example, can be used. Looking at the references that I have used for this publication, I want to emphasize the book from Klaus Engel, Markus Hartwiger, and colleagues again, The Survey of Volume Illumination Techniques, from the group in Norrköping, Jönsson, Sunden, Jünnermann, and Timo Opinski. I mentioned the cinematic rendering. So here is a first paper on the cinematic renderer. So it's indeed from 2016, as I supposed. And here are some further references. I have not emphasized any of them in particular. You see that Mark Levoy occurs here quite often and here as well. So he was the supervisor of this PhD thesis. So he was really instrumental in the early years of volume rendering. Yeah, with this, I want to thank you for your attention.